This argument is irrelevant. It's not real. Look, yourself. If it's not real, then what are you doing here? Why did you come back? Why do you find it so hard to believe?
Why do you find it so easy?
It's never been easy.
If you're going to be a Christian, you're going to fight a terrible mental battle to walk with God. There's a spirit like none other you'll ever face in your lifetime. If you're going to walk with God, you're going to fight. You're going to fight in your mind. It's the deepest battle you will ever fight, and it never ends. It's not just a church-related thing. It's being a Christian in this environment of whatever it means to be a Christian. I want to speak to you about the secret war of every saint. Father, I thank you, Lord God, for the anointing of your Holy Spirit. I thank you for your strength and your power. I thank you, God Almighty, for igniting this word in our hearts and using it to destroy every weapon of darkness that is formed against us. We curse in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ every tongue that rises against us in judgment. We have the right to condemn it. This is the scripture says, this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. We have a righteousness given to us of God. We stand right, we stand clean, we stand accepted. And God, you have a plan for each of our lives that will not be short-circuited by the powers of darkness. It cannot be unless we choose to forfeit it. Now, Father, I thank you for this. I pray, God, with all my heart, Lord, let this word find its mark in every heart. Give us grace and victory this day in Jesus' name. Psalm 3, a psalm of David, King David of Israel, when he was fleeing from his son Absalom, who rose up against him in rebellion. Lord, how many, or how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which say of my soul, there is no help for him in God. That's an incredible statement. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory and the lifter of mine head. I cried unto the Lord with my voice, and he heard me out of his holy hill. I laid me down and slept. I waked, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people that have set themselves against me round about. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God. For thou hast smitten all mine enemies upon the cheekbone. Thou hast broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongs unto the Lord, and thy blessing is upon thy people. Now, when David wrote this, he's struggling with a sense of past failure and present weakness. And that can be the portion of many of God's people. We look back and we feel like there are things in all of our lives that we would like to have done better. Mistakes that we made. David had made a terrible mistake at this case, this point in his life. He doesn't fully realize, perhaps, he's still on the victory side. God is still proud of him. The lineage of Christ is still going to physically flow through him, plus the spiritual promise of the blessing of God through Abraham still is being furthered through his body. But he has a past failure and he has some present weakness. Deep sense of perhaps that I'm far from where I should be. I'm not what I'm called to be. I thought my life was going to, and my character was going to change more rapidly than it did. I never thought I would respond the way I've been responding to people, maybe in the workplace, in your home, family. I came home with such promise, but I seem to have made so many mistakes. Paul wrote about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 5. He talked about being in Macedonia, a specific part of his journey, and he said, our flesh had no rest. We were troubled on every side. Outside of us or without were fightings. Within were fears. In other words, there are voices that have been raised against the Apostle Paul and his company on the outside. Mocking voices, cursing voices, all types of things that are coming against him. And it's producing inside of him an inner fear where there's now a new whole level of voices that Paul had to contend with. It's the voice of his own heart. It's that which found a seed inside of him, that which is threatening his life in Christ at this particular moment by taking away his faith and courage and putting fear again inside of his heart. Because of the depth of the struggle, David's heart became open to these condemning voices, both from outside and now from inside, coming out of the fears of his own heart. Many, he said, are troubling me. Many are risen against me. Many are saying, of my soul, there is no help for him in God. You remember as he's leaving Jerusalem, even this unsavory character called Shimei is up on the hillside casting stones and cursing his name. David said, leave him alone. Maybe God will hear his cursing and choose to have mercy on me. Another psalmist in Psalm 77 describes it this way. He talks about his own infirmity at the end of these verses. He said, then I realized this was coming out of the frailty of my own human heart. We must be careful, you and I, because we can get in situations where our own heart begins to take over for the voice of God. We create inner voices that really don't belong to God. They're not part of Scripture. They're not true. But this psalmist was in a moment of despair, as somebody is here this morning. And here's what he said. Will the Lord cast off forever? Number one mistake, he wasn't cast off, but he felt like he was cast off. And will he be favorable no more? Second mistake, he thought he had lost the favor of God on his life. But in reality, the favor of God was just as strong as it had been when he was living on the mountaintop. He just wasn't aware of it. We need to be careful what we start thinking when we find ourselves in a valley. Verse 8, he says, is his mercy clean gone forever? Has he forgotten to be mercy? Does his promise fail forevermore? Can I trust the promises of God? What happened to the promise of God that I would have a new heart, a new mind, and a new spirit, that my house would be saved if I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and trust him? What happened to the promise of God that the woundings of the past wouldn't continue to burden me down any longer, and I wouldn't live with that continual sorrow and heaviness in my heart. Has God forgotten to be gracious? He says in verse 9. Is he busy? Has he forgotten to be kind to me? Or has he in anger shut up his tender mercies? The psalmist is saying, did I do something wrong? Did I offend God? Have I crossed a line? Did God finally look down on me and said, I've just wasted so much time with this person. I'm not going to waste any more time trying to infuse life and gifts and talents and such like when they're refused to be used. Has he shut up his mercy because he's found some flaw in me that I'm aware of, but he is more aware of even than I am? This is the secret war of every saint. Moments when we get weary with the journey. We get tired of seemingly always walking uphill. We get worn down by the voices that are constantly condemning our progress. We sometimes wish that we could just stay asleep and make it all go away. Has that ever happened to you? You ever just wish that you could stay sleeping because there's peace there? And you hate the moment when you wake up because you've got to face it all over again. You go to bed at night and say, oh, would be to God I could die in my sleep and wake up in heaven. It'd be awesome. It's difficult to live in relationships or in a home, a household where you're demeaned. It's hard to be maybe the only believer in your house or one of two in a marriage and your partner's not saved and they mock you're going to church and they're so quick to point out your every flaw. You're believing God for change, but you have another voice when you get home that says, oh, look at this, I thought you were a Christian. Look at that, I thought you were a Christian. Look at that, I thought your character had changed. They push all your buttons all day, and when you finally respond to something, then aha, out comes the threatening finger. Or you're in a school system that declares you as irrelevant. You're not a functioning, productive member of society because you hold to these narrow, bigoted views of Judeo-Christian ethic. And so we don't want to hear from you. We don't want to hear your argument. It's outdated. It's passé. We're now a post-Christian society. So get over that and come along with us on the journey of enlightenment and wonderment and freedom and all the rest of it. It's hard to get up every day for college students and go into a classroom, or high school students and go into a classroom where what you believe is mocked as narrow, bigoted, uninformed, and uneducated. Or on a job where your integrity and work ethic are hated. You make the choice to be a good employee. You make the choice to write honestly in the books. You make the choice to tell the truth about why certain appointments can't be fulfilled and such like. And you're hated for it by not only your co-workers, but even some of those that are over you. Or to be in a place that declares your dreams unreachable. You can find yourself in a neighborhood, a culture, a society, where all around you, you have an inner dream. It's put there by God. God spoke something into your heart, and maybe like Joseph, you've gone out and told somebody, but you're in an environment that is completely hostile to it. You're told to wake up, get real. Nobody gets out of this place. You'll never be what you think in your heart has been given to you. It's hard to live in a society that calls the good that you embrace evil, and evil that you hate, they call it good. Every day, walking through the streets, the psalmist said there are many, many voices which say there is no help for him in God. In other words, nothing will make a difference. The downward spiral is irreversible. Give up the fight. That's exactly what the devil is after. Give up. Give up believing for your home. Give up believing that you can make a difference. Give up the dream that God has planted in your heart. Give up on your marriage and just simply walk out. Your partner's never going to get saved. Give up on the society around you and just shut yourself away and sleep away the rest of your life. Be satisfied with just being called a disciple of Jesus Christ, but don't ever believe that your life can make a difference. There's so many voices now saying these things. I think about Lazarus, and in my mind's eye, after he was raised from the dead, John chapter 12 says he was sitting at the table with Jesus, raised from the dead. And not only did people come to see Jesus, but the Bible said they also came to see Lazarus, who was raised from the dead. And even the Pharisees were hanging around outside the window, plotting how to put this man to death. Because of him, people were believing in Jesus. Imagine that. Poor fellow, he gets raised from the dead, and our people want to kill him. And I can see him. It's only my imagination, but I can see Lazarus at the table, and people coming and saying, how did it happen? How did you get this divine life infused within you? How did you get taken out of a hopeless place? I could hear him say to the people, I was so sick, I was so down, things were looking so bad. Jesus had come before, and he was part of our family. I was sure he was going to come and help me. But around me, as light began to fade in my soul, I began to increasingly hear voices talking about the hopelessness of the situation and how moment by moment it was getting worse. You ever heard a voice like that? The hopelessness of believing your children are going to come to God and how moment by moment, even though you pray, Jesus doesn't seem to be showing up and the situation seems to be getting worse all the time. You pray for the people on your job and moment by moment it's getting worse to the natural eye. Lazarus would say, I heard voices around me when I was laying down in my place of despair, declaring that for some unknown reason, Jesus hadn't come. And then finally I heard voices saying that the end had come. Many there be which save my soul. There is no help for him in God. That's the ultimate goal of the devil, is to get you to agree with that statement, to get you to the place of saying, not even God can help me now. And I don't know why, but even if I believe he could, he's not going to. He's found some flaw in me. His promises to me no longer apply. I've come out of favor, and he's angry with me, and he's shut up his tender mercy from me. And so finally, this voice comes and says, the end has come. And Lazarus would tell him, and also my own voice, in a final inner cry for mercy before I fell asleep. Verses 4 and 5, he said, I cried unto the Lord with my voice. In verse 5, it says, I laid me down and slept. And some of you, that's exactly where you are right now. You cried when you went to sleep last night. You don't know how you're going to get out of your situation. You don't see any light at the end of the tunnel. And before you fell asleep, you cried one last, and it's almost like the whispering, a pitiful cry. It says, oh God, please help me. I don't know how I'm going to go on. I don't know how I'm going to get through this. And that's what David said. I cried to the Lord with my voice, and I laid me down and slept. Just like Elijah, after depression settled in on his life, he had won marvelous victories, but he succumbed to a voice that said, I'm going to take your head before this day is over. And it sent him to a place of seclusion and depression, a place where all he could produce is a whisper for God and a wish that he could lay down, go to sleep, and never wake up again. And Lazarus would have told them, that's all I had left. All I had left was a whisper. Jesus, don't forget me. Jesus, help me. And maybe that's the only prayer you feel today that you've got left. But then the testimony doesn't stop there. As people gather in that room and they gather around the table, Lazarus would say to them, but then there was one more voice, and it was a voice like no other I had ever heard in my life. I had heard this voice before, but never with this kind of power. It was a voice that had the power to call me out of hopelessness. It was a voice that had the power to hold me in the palm of its hand. It was the voice that had the power to give life where there is no life and give hope where there is no hope. It was a voice that drowned out. It was spoken so loud that it drowned out the voices of all the wailers, all the weepers, all the prognosticators, all the ones gathered around where I was, saying, too bad, so sad, not even God could do anything now. Too bad he didn't come. Too bad it's too late. Suddenly, I heard a voice, and it was so loud, it drowned out every other voice, everything that was being spoken around me, and it simply called my name. That's all this voice did. It called my name and called me to come out of where I was into another place that he had predestined for my life to live in him.
Five missions, you've tried special evangelists, haven't you tried God?
Gotta say God bless you.